even if the most trustworthy of men, assures me that he knows things are thus and so. This by itself cannot satisfy me that he does know, only that he believes he knows. That's why G.E. Moore's assurance that he knows does not interest us. The propositions, however, which Moore retails as examples of such known truths are indeed interesting, not because anyone knows their truth or believes he knows them, but because they all have a similar role in the system of our empirical judgments. We don't, for example, arrive at any of them as a result of investigation. There are, e.g., historical investigations and investigations into the shape and also the age of the Earth, but not into whether the Earth has existed during the last 100 years. Of course, many of us have information about this period from our parents and grandparents, but mayn't they be wrong? Nonsense, one will say. How should all these people be wrong? But is that an argument? Is it not simply the rejection of an idea and perhaps the determination of a concept? For if I speak of a possible mistake here, this changes the role of mistake and of truth in our lives. Not only rules, but also examples are needed for establishing a practice. Our rules leave loopholes open, and the practice has to speak for itself. We don't learn the practice of making empirical judgments by learning rules. We are taught judgments and their connection with other judgments. A totality of judgments is made plausible to us. When we first begin to believe anything, what we believe is not a single proposition. It's a whole system of propositions. Light dawns gradually over the whole. It's not single axioms that strike me as obvious. It's a system in which consequences and premises give one another mutual support. I'm told, for example, that someone climbed this mountain many years ago. Do I always inquire into the reliability of the teller of this story and whether the mountain did exist years ago? A child learns there are reliable and unreliable informants much later than it learns facts which are told it. It doesn't learn at all that the mountain has existed for a long time. That is, the question whether it is so doesn't arise at all. It swallows this consequence down, so to speak, together with what it learns. The child learns to believe a host of things, i.e. it learns to act according to these beliefs. Bit by bit, there forms a system of what is believed, and in that system, some things stand unshakably fast, and some are more or less liable to shift. What stands fast does so, not because it's intrinsically obvious or convincing. It is rather held fast by what lies around it. One wants to say, quote, all my experiences show that it's so, quote. But how do they do that? For that proposition to which they point itself belongs to a particular interpretation of them. That I regard this proposition as certainly true also characterizes my interpretation of experience. We form the picture of the Earth as a ball floating free in space and not altering essentially in 100 years. I said we form the picture, etc. And this picture now helps us in the judgment of various situations. I may indeed calculate the dimensions of a bridge, sometimes calculate that here things are more in favor of a bridge than a ferry, etc., etc., but somewhere I must begin with an assumption or a decision. The picture of the Earth as a ball is a good picture. It proves itself everywhere. It's also a simple picture. In short, we work with it without doubting it. Why do I not satisfy myself that I have 2 feet when I want to get up from a chair? There is no why. I simply don't. This is how I act. My judgments themselves characterize the way I judge, characterize the nature of judgment. How does someone judge which is his right and which is his left hand? How do I know that my judgment will agree with someone else's? How do I know that this color is blue? If I don't trust myself here, why should I trust anyone else's judgment? Is there a why? Must I not begin to trust somewhere? That is to say, somewhere I must begin with not doubting. And that is not, so to speak, hasty, but excusable. It's part of judging. I should like to say, G.E. Moore does not know what he asserts he knows, but it stands fast for him, and also for me. Regarding it as absolutely solid is part of our method of doubt and inquiry. I don't explicitly learn the propositions that stand fast for me. I can discover them subsequently, like the axis around which a body rotates. This axis is not fixed in the sense that anything holds it fast, but the movement around it determines its immobility. No one ever taught me that my hands don't disappear when I'm not paying attention to them, nor can I be said to presuppose the truth of this proposition in my assertions, etc., while it only gets sense from the rest of our procedure of asserting. There are cases such that if someone gives signs of doubt where we do not doubt, we cannot confidently understand his signs as signs of doubt, i.e., if we are to understand his signs of doubt as such, he may give them only in particular cases and may not give them in others. In certain circumstances, a man cannot make a mistake. Can is here used logically, and the proposition does not mean that a man cannot say anything false in those circumstances. If G.E. Moore were to pronounce the opposite of those propositions, which he declares certain, we should not just not share his opinion, we should regard him as demented. In order to make a mistake, a man must already judge in conformity with mankind. Suppose a man could not remember whether he had always had five fingers or two hands. Should we understand him? Could we be sure of understanding him? Can I be making a mistake, for example, in thinking that the words of which this sentence is composed are English words whose meanings I know? As children, we learn facts, e.g. that every human being has a brain, and we take them on trust. I believe that there is an island, Australia, of such and such a shape, and so on and so on. I believe that I had great-grandparents, and the people who gave themselves out as my parents really were my parents, etc. This belief may never have been expressed. Even the thought that it was so never thought. The child learns by believing the adult. Doubt comes after belief. I learned an enormous amount and accepted it on human authority. And then I found some things confirmed or disconfirmed by my own experience. In general, I take as true what is found in textbooks of geography, for example. Why? I say all these facts have been confirmed 100 times over. But how do I know that? What is my evidence for it? Well, I have a world picture. Is it true or false? Above all, it is the substratum of all my inquiring and asserting. The propositions describing it are not all equally subject to testing. Does anyone ever test whether this table remains in existence when no one is paying attention to it? We check the story of Napoleon, but not whether all the reports about him are based on sense deception, forgery, and the like. For whenever we test anything, we are already presupposing something that is not tested. Now, am I to say that the experiment, which perhaps I make in order to test the truth of a proposition, presupposes the truth of the proposition that the apparatus I believe I see is really there, and the like? Doesn't testing come to an end? One child might say to another, I know that the earth is already hundreds of years old, and that would mean I've learned it. The difficulty is to realize the groundlessness of our believing. It's clear that our empirical propositions don't all have the same status, since one can lay down such a proposition and turn it from an empirical proposition into a norm of description. Think of chemical investigations. Lavoisier makes experiments with substances in his laboratory, and now he concludes that this and that takes place when there is burning. He doesn't say that it might happen otherwise, another time. He's got hold of a definite world picture. Not, of course, one he invented. He learned it as a child. I say world picture and not hypothesis because it's the matter of course foundation for his research, and as such also goes unmentioned. But now, what part is played by the presupposition that substance A always reacts with substance B in the same way, given the same circumstances? Or is that part of the definition of a substance? One might think that there were propositions declaring that chemistry is possible, and these would be propositions of a natural science, for what should they be supported by, if not by experience? I believe what people transmit to me in a certain manner. In this way, I believe geographical, chemical, historical facts, etc. This is how I learn the sciences. Of course, learning is based on believing. If you have learned that Mont Blanc is 4,000 meters high, if you have looked it up on the map, you say you know it. And can it now be said we accord credence in this way because it has proved to pay? A principal ground for Moore to assume that he never was on the moon is that no one ever was on the moon or could go there. And this we believe on the grounds of what we learn. Perhaps someone says there must be some basic principle on which we give credence. But what can such a principle accomplish? Is it more than a natural law of taking for true? Is it maybe in my power what I believe, or what I unshakably believe? I believe that there's a chair over there. Can't I be wrong? But can I believe that I'm wrong? Or can I so much as bring it under consideration? And mightn't I also hold fast to my belief, whatever I learned later on? But is my belief then grounded? I act with complete certainty, but this certainty is my own. I know it, I say to someone else, and here there is a justification, but there is none for my belief. Instead of I know it, one may say in some cases, that's how it is, rely upon it. In some cases, I learned it years and years ago. And sometimes one may say, I'm sure it is so. What I know, I believe. The wrong use made by G.E. Moore of the proposition I know lies in his regarding it as an utterance as little subject to doubt as I am in pain. And since from I know it is so, there follows it is so, then the latter can't be doubted either. It would be correct to say I believe X has subjective truth, but I know X not. Or again, I believe X is an expression, but not I know X. Suppose Moore said I swear instead of I know. The more primitive idea is that the earth never had a beginning. No child has reason to ask himself how long the earth has existed because all change takes place on it. If what's called the earth really came into existence at some time, which is hard enough to picture, then one naturally assumes the beginning as having been an inconceivably long time ago. Someone says, it's certain that after the Battle of Austerlitz, Napoleon did X, Y, Z. Well, in that case, it's surely also certain that the earth existed then. Someone says, quote, it's certain that we didn't arrive on this planet from another one 100 years ago, quote. Well, it's as certain as such things are. It would strike me as ridiculous to want to doubt the existence of Napoleon. But if someone doubted the existence of the Earth 150 years ago, perhaps I should be more willing to listen. For now he is doubting our whole system of evidence. It does not strike me as if this system were more certain than a certainty within it. But imagine someone says, quote, I might suppose that Napoleon never existed and is a fable, but not that the Earth didn't exist 150 years ago. Someone says, do you know that the Earth existed then? And someone responds, of course I know that. I have it from someone who certainly knows all about it. It strikes me as if someone who doubts the existence of the Earth at that time is impugning the nature of all historical evidence. And I cannot say of this latter, of all historical evidence, that it is definitely correct. At some point, one has to pass from explanation to mere description. What we call historical evidence points to the existence of the Earth a long time before my birth. The opposite hypothesis has nothing on its side. Well, if everything speaks for a hypothesis and nothing against it, is it then certainly true? One may designate it as such, but does it certainly agree with reality, with the facts? With this question, you are already going round in a circle. To be sure, there is justification, but justification comes to an end. What does this mean, the truth of a proposition is certain? With the word certain, we express complete conviction and the total absence of doubt, and thereby we seek to convince other people. That is subjective certainty. But when is something objectively certain? When a mistake is not possible. But what kind of possibility is that? Mustn't mistake be logically excluded? If I believe that I'm sitting in my room when I'm not, then I shall not be said to have made a mistake. But what's the essential difference between this case and a mistake? Sure evidence is what we accept as sure. It's evidence that we go by in acting surely, acting without any doubt. What we call, quote, a mistake plays a quite special part in our language games. And so too does what we consider to be certain evidence. It would be nonsense to say that we regard something as sure evidence because it's certainly true. Rather, we must first determine the role of deciding for or against a proposition. The reason why the use of the expression, quote, true or false, has something misleading about it is that it's like saying, quote, it tallies with the facts or it doesn't. And the very thing that is in question is what tallying is here. Really, quote, the proposition is either true or false only means that it must be possible to decide for or against it. But this does not say what the ground for such a decision is like. Suppose someone were to ask, quote, is it really right for us to rely on the evidence of our memory or of our senses as we do? Well, G.E. Moore's certain propositions almost declare that we have a right to rely upon this evidence. Everything that we regard as evidence indicates that the Earth already existed long before my birth. The contrary hypothesis has nothing to confirm it at all. If everything speaks for a hypothesis and nothing against it, is it objectively certain? One can call it that, but does it necessarily agree with the world of facts? At the very best, it shows us what agreement means. We find it difficult to imagine it to be false, but also difficult to make use of it. What does this agreement consist in, if not in the fact that what is evidence in these language games speaks for our proposition, Tractatus Logico-Philosophicus? Giving grounds, however, justifying the evidence, comes to an end. But the end is not certain propositions striking us immediately as true, i.e., it's not a kind of seeing on our part, it's our acting which lies at the bottom of the language game. Well, if the true is what is grounded, then the ground is not true, nor yet false. Repeating for those needing.
If the true is what is grounded, then the ground is not true, nor yet false.
If someone asked us, quote, but is that true, quote, we might say yes to him. And if he demanded grounds, we might say, quote, I can't give you any grounds. But if you learn more, you too will think the same. If this didn't come about, that would mean that he couldn't, for example, learn history. Someone says, strange coincidence that every man whose skull has been opened had a brain. How about this? I have a telephone conversation with New York. My friend tells me that his young trees have buds of such and such a kind. I am now convinced that his tree is XYZ. Am I also convinced that the earth exists? The existence of the earth is rather part of the whole picture, which forms the starting point of belief for me. Does my telephone call to New York strengthen my conviction that the earth exists? Much seems to be fixed, and it is removed from the traffic. It is, so to speak, shunted onto the unused siding. Now, it gives our way of looking at things and our researches their form. Perhaps it was once disputed, but perhaps for unthinkable ages it has belonged to the scaffolding of our thoughts. Every human being has parents. In certain circumstances, we think of a calculation as sufficiently checked. What gives us a right to do so? Experience? May that not have deceived us? Somewhere we must be finished with justification, and then there remains the proposition that this is how we calculate. Our empirical propositions do not form a homogeneous mass. What prevents me from supposing that this table either vanishes or alters its shape and color when no one is observing it, and then when someone looks at it again, changes back to its old condition? Quote, but who is going to suppose such a thing? Quote, one would feel like saying. Here we see that the idea of agreement with reality does not have any clear application. The proposition, quote, it is written, quote. If someone supposed that all our calculations were uncertain and that we could rely on none of them, justifying himself by saying that mistakes are always possible, perhaps we would say he was crazy. But can we say he's in error? Does he not just react differently? We rely on calculations. He doesn't. We are sure he isn't. Can I believe for one moment that I've ever been in the stratosphere? No. So do I know the contrary, like G.E. Moore does? There cannot be any doubt about it for me, as a reasonable person. That's it. The reasonable man does not have certain doubts. Can I be in doubt at will? I say, can I be in doubt at will? I cannot possibly doubt that I was never in the stratosphere. Does that make me know it? Does that make it true? For mightn't I be crazy and not doubting what I absolutely ought to doubt? Someone says, I know that it never happened, for if it had happened, I could not possibly have forgotten it. But supposing it did happen, then it just would have been the case that you had forgotten it. And how do you know that you could not possibly have forgotten it? Isn't that just from earlier experience? What I hold fast to is not one proposition, but a nest of propositions. Oh, can I give the supposition that I've ever been on the moon any serious consideration at all? Is that something one can forget? In such circumstances, people don't say, perhaps we've all forgotten, and the like, but rather they assume that XYZ. Our talk, our speech, gets its meaning from the rest of our proceedings. We're asking ourselves, what do we do with the statement, quote, I know, dot, dot, dot? For it's not a question of mental processes or mental states, and that's how one must decide whether something is knowledge or not. If someone doubted whether the earth existed 100 years ago, I shouldn't understand for this reason. I wouldn't know what such a person would still allow to be counted as evidence and what not. Someone says, we could doubt every single one of these facts, but we couldn't doubt them all. Wouldn't it be more correct to say, we do not doubt them all? Our not doubting them all is simply our manner of judging, and therefore of acting. If a child asked me whether the earth was already there before my birth, I should answer him that the earth did not begin only with my birth, but that it existed long, long before. And I should have the feeling of saying something funny, rather as if the child had asked if such and such a mountain were higher than a tall house that it had seen. In answering the question, I should have to be imparting a picture of the world to the person who asked it. And if I do answer the question with certainty, what gives me this certainty? I believe that I have forebears, and that every human being has them. I believe that there are various cities, and quite generally, in the main facts of geography and history. I believe that the earth is a body on whose surface we move, and that it no more suddenly disappears or the like than any other solid body, this table, this house, this tree, etc. If I wanted to doubt the existence of the earth long before my birth, I should have to doubt all sorts of things that stand fast for me. And that something stands fast for me is not grounded in my stupidity or credulity. If someone said, quote, the earth has not long been, ... quote, what would he be impugning? Do I know? Would it have to be what is called a scientific belief? Might it not be a mystical one? Is there any absolute necessity for him to be contradicting historical facts, or even geographical ones? If I say an hour ago this table didn't exist, I probably mean that it was only made later on. If I say this mountain didn't exist then, I presumably mean that it was only formed later on, perhaps by a volcano. If I say this mountain didn't exist half an hour ago, that is such a strange statement that it's not clear what I mean. Whether, for example, I mean something untrue but scientific. Perhaps you think that the statement that the mountain didn't exist then is quite clear, however one conceives the context. But suppose someone said, quote, this mountain didn't exist a minute ago, but an exactly similar one did instead, quote. Only the accustomed context allows what is meant to come through clearly. I might therefore interrogate someone who said that the earth did not exist before his birth in order to find out which of my convictions he was at odds with. And then it might be that he was contradicting my fundamental attitudes that were how it was, and if I should have to put up with it. And similarly, if he said he had, at some time, been on the moon, I believe that every human being has two human parents, but Catholics believe that Jesus only had a human mother. And other people might believe that there are human beings with no parents and give no credence to all the contrary evidence. Catholics believe as well that in certain circumstances, a wafer completely changes its nature, and at the same time that all evidence proves the contrary. And so if Moore said, quote, I know that this is wine and not blood, quote, Catholics would contradict him. What's the belief that all human beings have parents based on? On experience. And how can I base this sure belief on my experience? Well, I base it not only on the fact that I have known the parents of certain people, but on everything that I have learnt about the sexual life of human beings and their anatomy and physiology, also on what I have heard and seen of animals. But then, is that really a proof? Isn't this a hypothesis? Which, as I believe, is again and again completely confirmed. Mustn't we say this at every turn? Quote, I believe this with certainty. Quote, one says, I know, when one is ready to give compelling grounds. I know relates to a possibility of demonstrating the truth. Whether someone knows something can come to light, assuming that he is convinced of it. But if what he believes is of such a kind that the grounds that he can give are no surer than his assertion, then he cannot say that he knows what he believes. If someone says, I have a body, he can be asked, who is speaking here with this mouth? To whom does anyone say that he knows something? To himself or to someone else? If he says it to himself, how is it distinguished from the assertion that he is sure that things are like that? There is no subjective sureness that I know something. The certainty is subjective, but not the knowledge. So if I say, quote, I know that I have two hands, quote, and that is not supposed to express just my subjective certainty, I must be able to satisfy myself that I am right. But I can't do that, for my having two hands is not less certain before I have looked at them than afterwards. But I could say, quote, that I have two hands is a irreversible belief, quote. That would express the fact that I'm not ready to let anything count as a disproof of this proposition. Someone says, here I have arrived at a foundation of all my beliefs. This position I will hold. But isn't that precisely only because I am completely convinced of it? What is being completely convinced like? What would it be like to doubt now whether I have two hands? Why can't I imagine it at all? What would I believe if I didn't believe that? So far, I have no system at all within which this doubt might exist. I've arrived at the rock bottom of my convictions, and one might almost say that these foundation walls are carried by the whole house. One gives oneself a false picture of doubt. My having two hands is, in normal circumstances, as certain as anything that I could produce in evidence for it. That's why I'm not in a position to take the sight of my hand as evidence for it. Doesn't this mean I shall proceed according to this belief unconditionally and not let anything confuse me? But it isn't just that I believe in this way that I have two hands, but that every reasonable person does. At the foundation of well-founded belief lies belief that is not founded. Any reasonable person behaves like this. Doubting has certain characteristic manifestations, but they're only characteristic of it in particular circumstances. If someone said that he doubted the existence of his hands, kept looking at them from all sides, tried to make sure it wasn't all done by mirrors, etc., we should not be sure whether we ought to call that doubting. We might describe his way of behaving as like the behavior of doubt, but his game would not be ours. On the other hand, a language game does change with time. If someone said to me that he doubted whether he had a body, I should take him to be a half-wit. But I shouldn't know what it would mean to try to convince him that he had one. And if I had said something and that had removed his doubt, I shouldn't know how or why. I don't know how the sentence, quote, I have a body, quote, is to be used. That doesn't unconditionally apply to the proposition that I have always been on or near the surface of the earth. Someone who doubted whether the earth had existed for 100 years might have a scientific, or on the other hand, a philosophical doubt. I would like to reserve the expression, I know, for the cases in which it is used in normal linguistic exchange. Once again, I'd like to reserve the expression I know for the cases in which it is used in normal linguistic exchange. I cannot, at present, imagine a reasonable doubt as to the existence of the Earth during the last 100 years. I can imagine a man who'd grown up in quite special circumstances and been taught that the Earth came into being only 50 years ago, and therefore believed this. We might instruct him, no, the Earth has been around a long, long time, etc. We should be trying to give him our picture of the world. This would happen through a kind of persuasion. The schoolboy believes his teachers and his school books. I could imagine G.E. Moore being captured by a wild tribe, and they're expressing the suspicion that he's come from somewhere between the Earth and the Moon. Moore tells him that he knows, etc. That's not true. But he can't give them the grounds for his certainty, because they have fantastic ideas of human ability to fly and know nothing about physics. This would be an occasion for making that statement, the one about knowing he's never been far from the surface of the Earth. But what does it say beyond just, quote, I have never been to such and such a place, and have compelling grounds for believing that, quote. And here one would still have to say, what are compelling grounds? Someone says, I don't merely have the visual impression of a tree. I know that it's a tree. Someone says, quote, I know that this is a hand, quote. And what is a hand? Then he says, quote, well, this, for example, quote, am I more certain that I've never been on the moon than that I've never been in Bulgaria? Why am I so sure? Well, I know that I've never been anywhere in the neighborhood. For example, I've never been in the Balkans. Someone says, quote, I have compelling grounds for my certitude, quote. These grounds make the certitude objective. What is a telling ground for something is not anything I decide. I know equals I'm familiar with it as a certainty. But when does one say of something that it is certain? For there can be dispute whether something is certain. I mean when something is objectively certain. Now there are countless general empirical propositions that count as certain for us. One such is that if someone's arm is cut off, it will not grow back. Another, if someone's head is cut off, he is dead and will never live again. Experience can be said to teach us these propositions. However, it does not teach us them in isolation. Rather, it teaches us a host of interdependent propositions. If they were isolated, I might perhaps doubt them, for I have no experience relating to them. If experience is the ground of our certainty, then naturally it's past experience. And it isn't, for example, just my experience, but other people's that I get knowledge from. Now, one might say that it is experience again that leads us to give credence to others. But what experience makes me believe that the anatomy and physiology books don't contain what is false? Though it is true that this trust is backed up by my own experience. We believe, so to speak, that this great building exists, and then we see here and there one or another small corner of it. Someone says, I can't help believing XYZ. Someone says, I'm comfortable that that is how things are. It's quite sure that motor cars don't grow out of the earth. We feel that if someone could believe the contrary, he could believe everything that we say is untrue and could question everything that we hold to be sure. But how does this one belief hang together with all the rest? We should like to say that someone who could believe that does not accept our whole system of verification. This system is something that a human being acquires by means of observation and instruction. I intentionally do not say learns. I said acquires. After he has seen this and this and heard that and that, he's not in a position to doubt whether such and such, X, Y, Z. I, LW, believe, am sure, that my friend hasn't got sawdust in his body or in his head, even though I have no direct evidence of my senses to the contrary. I am sure, by reason of what has been said to me, of what I've read and of my experience, to have doubts about it would seem to me madness. Of course, this is also in agreement with other people, but I do agree with them. I can't say that I have good grounds for the opinion that cats don't grow on trees, or that I had a father and a mother. If someone has doubts about it, how is that supposed to have come about? By his never from the beginning having believed that he had parents? But then is that conceivable, unless he has been taught that? For how can a child immediately doubt what he's taught? That could mean only that he was incapable of learning certain language games. People have killed animals since the earliest times, used the fur, bones, etc. for various purposes. They have counted definitely on finding similar parts in any similar beast. They've always learned from experience, and we can see from their actions that they believe certain things definitely, whether they express this belief or not. By this, I naturally don't want to say that men should behave like this, but only that they do behave like this. If someone's looking for something, and perhaps roots around in a certain place, he shows that he believes that what he is looking for is there. What we believe depends on what we learn. We all believe that it is impossible to get to the moon. But there might be people who believe that that is possible and that it sometimes happens. We say, these people do not know a lot that we know. And let them be never so sure of their belief. They are wrong and we know it. If we compare our system of knowledge with theirs, then theirs is evidently the poorer one by far. The squirrel does not infer by induction that it's going to need stored food next winter as well. And no more do we need a law of induction to justify our actions or our predictions. I know not just that the earth existed long before my birth, but also that it's a large body, that this has been established, and that I and the rest of mankind have forebears. And there are books about all this, that such books don't lie, etc. And I know all this? Well, I believe it. This body of knowledge has been handed on to me, and I have no grounds for doubting it, but on the contrary, all sorts of confirmation. And why shouldn't I say that I know all this? Isn't that what one does say? But not only I know or believe all that, but others do too. Or rather, I believe that they believe it. I'm firmly convinced that others believe they know, that all that is in fact so. I myself wrote in my book that children learn to understand a word in such and such a way. Do I know that? Or do I believe it? Why in such a case do I write not, I believe that children learn to understand a word in such and such a way, but simply use the indicative sentence instead? We know that the earth is round. We have definitely ascertained that it's round. We'll stick to this opinion unless our whole way of seeing nature changes. Someone says, how do you know that? Well, I believe it. Further experiments can't give the lie to our earlier ones. At most, they may change our whole way of looking at things. Similarly, with the sentence, water boils at 100 degrees Celsius. This is how we acquire conviction. This is called being rightly convinced. So hasn't one, in this sense, a proof of the proposition? But that the same thing has happened again is not a proof of it, though we do say that it gives us a right to assume it. This is what we call an empirical foundation for our assumptions. For we learn not just that such and such experiments had those results, but also the conclusion which is drawn. And of course, there is nothing wrong in our doing so, for this inferred proposition is an instrument for a definite use. The saying, we are quite sure of it, does not mean that every single person is certain of it, but that we belong to a community which is bound together by science and education. And we are satisfied that the earth is round. Not all corrections of our views are on the same level. Suppose it wasn't true that the earth had already existed long before I was born. How should we imagine the mistake being discovered? It's no good saying, perhaps we are wrong, when, if no evidence is trustworthy, trust is excluded in the case of the present evidence. In other words, we also can't trust what we are using as the ground of our doubting. If, for example, we've always been miscalculating, and 12 squared isn't equal to 144, why should we trust any other calculation? And of course, that is wrongly put. But nor am I making a mistake about 12 times 12 equaling 144. I may say later that I was confused just now, but not that I was making a mistake. Here once more, there's needed a step like the one taken in relativity theory. Someone says, I don't know if this is a hand. But do you know what the word hand means? And don't say, I know what it means now for me. And isn't it an empirical fact that this word is used like this? And here the strange thing is that when I'm quite certain of how the words are used, have no doubt about it, I can still give no grounds for my way of going on. Oh, if I tried, I could give 1,000, but none as certain as the very thing they were supposed to be grounds for. What we call knowledge and certainty belong to different categories. They are not two mental states, like, say, surmising and being sure. And here I assume that it's meaningful for me to say I know what, e.g., the word doubt means, and that this sentence indicates that the word doubt has a logical role. What interests us now is not being sure, but knowledge. That is, we're interested in the fact that about certain empirical propositions, no doubt can exist if making judgments is to be possible at all. Or again, I'm inclined to believe that not everything that has the form of an empirical proposition is one. Is it that rule and empirical proposition merge into one another?
I just can't get over losing you. So if I seem broken in two, please walk on by. Walk on by. Foolish pride, that's all that I have left. Let me hide the tears and the sadness you gave me. You put the hate on me, you socked it to me, mama, when you said goodbye.